So again, welcome. We're going to be going through SOLIDWORKS Simulation, and this topic we're going to cover vibration analysis. And again, my name is Walt Bednarz with Prism Engineering. And just kind of kick things off, we're going to go through a few questions here. Actually, just a very important one here. I want to make sure that you can just hear the audio. Also, if you can see the screen, just need to make sure that you're getting the audio coming through. So it looks like everyone can hear our audio at this point, so that's good. I got rid of my mute button. I turned that off and made sure that you can hear. All right, so a couple of questions here another question here real quick. Just wanted to get an idea. Do you do things to optimize your design today? Are you going through any kind of analytical methods to check your designs, whether it's using simulation tools from SOLIDWORKS, the Express tools, or if you're just doing hand calculations? All right, so it looks like some of you are doing some simulation work there. All right. So this is actually part two in a three-part series of our simulation event, and we're using a data set that we used at our rollouts. We're using our quadcopter for this, and a couple of weeks ago we did a structural analysis presentation for a little bit over a half hour, and we covered things like linear statics analysis, and we covered also some nonlinear analysis as well. And in this one we're going to cover vibration analysis. The other one, we also covered a little bit of some best practices and some suggestions on simplification. We're not going to cover as much of that here. Part of that is just because we went over our time by about 15, 20 minutes last time. So we're just going to focus on a couple of vibrations examples that we can go through with SOLIDWORKS Simulation. At the end, I'll give a link to the part three of our webinar series that we're doing on simulation. The next one's going to be on fatigue and buckling, and we're going to, again, work with this data set, our quadcopter. So we're going to cover two main topics here of vibration analysis. We're going to cover natural frequencies. We're just looking for the resonant frequencies in our design. And then we're also going to go through a harmonic response type analysis. So let's say we have some kind of an actuator. Like in our case, we have motors here, and they can run through a range of speeds. And we want to see, like, what's the response from the system, from the structural components, when it sees some kind of a load at different varying frequencies. So we're going to put in some input values on that, and I'm going to speak to, like, how you can maybe get some of that information in the future, like some of the coefficients that are necessary for damping and things of that nature. But these are two examples of what you can do for vibration analysis. There's several more that you can cover that may be more specific to your needs. So we'll mention a few others that SOLIDWORKS can cover. So let's go ahead and now get into our demonstration at this point. And we're going to start off very simple. We're just going to work with our assembly that we have here. And we're going to go and do a natural frequency analysis. Now, in our last presentation, we talked about some simplification methods to not have to mesh everything. Like you can see here all the detail we have in our design. Like you can see coils inside of our motor, not just the fillets that we're talking about, but all the different features that are here for the electronics. Since we meshed a geometry, we don't want all that geometry in there. So we want to simplify this design before proceeding with meshing, setting up our finite element model. I'm going to drink a little bit of water there just so I can kind of make sure my throat doesn't dry up here. But just looking on the side here, you can see I have some configurations set up that are of simplified variations of our design. And if I go through some of these here, you can see I have one that's set up for symmetry. Now, in structural, a lot of times we want to use symmetry just to reduce the number of degrees of freedom, number of elements that exist in here. Problem is, in this case here, when we're doing natural frequency analysis, we could wind up actually removing some modal shapes and miss some of the natural frequencies. So it's not the best scenario for what we're doing. So I'm actually going to go and use this example here. I have a simplified model where we took out some of the platforms in here, took out the electronics and the motors. But when I set up my previous study, I had set up lumped masses or remote masses to capture the mass influence for my natural frequency or my structural analysis without having to have all that mesh geometry, just a single node with the geometric, or I should say the mass information that's necessary. Now, instead of duplicating to get to my natural frequency study, I am going to start a completely new study. I'll just choose a frequency option here, and I'll name this natural frequency. Now, because I didn't duplicate that, and I can't actually duplicate that into a natural frequency, I have to start a new natural frequency. I can't duplicate from a static study into that. I can still take information from my previous study and drag it over. So I can go here and just select these entities and bring them into my new study. So I can reuse that information. I can look through some of the details here, like I have the properties on these parts. I'm going to go in here and just right mouse click and say, let's make this, in this case, we're going to make it an aluminum frame instead of a plastic. So we'll go in here and say, let's look for aluminums. And we're going to say that this is a 6061. So we're assuming that maybe our initial designs, we were machining this out of a lightweight metal, very strong metal. That's where our design started. We can see that that's applied in there. And I could have dragged this over as well. Now, next step, I'm going to go ahead and create my mesh. Now, typically when we start off, we're working with a draft quality mesh. As we start working towards convergence, we're going to use a high quality mesh that gives us a higher order element, better accuracy, and then we're going to also do things like increase the number of elements and areas of concern. For presentation purposes, and since we're starting out, we're just going to stick with that draft quality mesh, and that's a first order, very fast mesh that we're going to be working with. You see there we got our mesh in place, and then a couple other things. If I want to see the number of frequencies I'm going to be looking for, I'm going to have SOLIDWORKS, I'm going to look at its properties for the study. I'm going to say let's maybe look for 10 natural frequencies. And I have some other settings here. We talked about them in our last, presentation, but different solvers we can choose and different ways we handle contact. I'm going to use this FFB Plus for now. For what we're working with, and we'll talk about that maybe a little bit more later. But then we'll go ahead and run our study. In my default settings, I have it set up that it's going to give me plots for 5 different mode shapes, even though I asked for 10. I can always add additional plots to my output, or I can go ahead and modify these. Now, my first few mode shapes are just going to be rigid body motion. Since I didn't fix this at the base in any way, it's showing me 0 hertz, and I can see that the geometry actually just translated from its original position. I can tell based on my icons or my entities showing from my remote masses. Now, I'm going to go in here and just say edit the definition of this, and you'll see that I can adjust which mode shape I want to look at. So maybe I'll bump this up, and I can see the value for that. These are still rigid body motion shapes, I can tell just by the value being so low. So I'll bump that up a bit, and I'll bring that up to where it sees 5 hertz, and that still seems kind of low to me. But once I observe that, I can see something doesn't look right to me. I can see that there's a gap that's forming here. So you really want to run that initial analysis in the simplest form. Like I use the first order draft quality elements, and then start looking at your mode shape and kind of inspect what's going on. And it'll tell you if you have a problem, rather than throwing at a lot of elements at it right away. So get those results right away, inspect what's going on, see if something's wrong. I can see the separation here, so maybe I'll go back and take a quick look at the model and see that that maybe there's a gap here, and I'm not getting contact between those because of that. And I have some other tools here that I could use to help me inspect that. Like I can right mouse click here, or one of these places right here where it says connections, and go to contact visualization plot and calculate. I can see where it is picking up contact and where it's not. So just some tools there to help me diagnose some of these problems. So I'm going to fix my contact here and say when I have non-touching faces, try to fill a gap element in there with some amount of spacing. And what we'll do is we'll remesh that. just a message there telling me it's going to make the results invalid when we do that, that remesh. And then we'll run the study. We'll give it a moment. It's going to kind of set up the information and send it over to the solver, and then it's going to start running through the studies and give me the feedback. When it's done, we'll take a look at some of the plots again. We'll also show you how you can list all the natural frequencies very quickly. We'll see here, it's taking a moment just to kind of send that information over. Once that's over, the solver will run very quickly. Often I kind of expand this here to see the degrees of freedom. You can see the results went so fast, we couldn't even read that off there, but it can give us some feedback on the degrees of freedom that exist in there. And there's my mode shape for this one that we were looking at, mode shape 8 now. And it's giving me the feedback which one we're looking at. And I can see it's deforming the body as we would expect. If I right mouse click on my results, I can also say list resonant frequencies to see just a quick list of the resonant frequencies that exist. So I have here like 28, 93 hertz, 124. So I may want to inspect some of these others, but it's a quick way of looking at that information. And then again, you can go in here and adjust your plot. So if I go and edit definition, I can say let's look at another mode shape, like mode shape 7 at 264 hertz, and see what that mode shape looks like. And you want to kind of cross-reference that with information, like if you know you have some kind of a cycling load that's occurring from an actuator, like a motor, and see if you're going to be running through that and maybe what kind of excitations and what kind of resonance may occur as you're checking your design. So the next thing we're going to do is we're going to take a look at a harmonic study or a harmonic response. And what we'll do is we'll take a look at just an individual part here when we do this. So I'm going to go ahead and open up this part, and we're going to set up our harmonic study this time. Now this is actually a two-step study. We do have to do perform a natural frequency on this as well. But I'm going to go in here and say let's select our linear dynamics, and I have several options down here. I have modal time history, I have random vibration, response spectral analysis or response spectrum analysis. We're going to work with harmonics here, but you get the idea that there's multiple study types we can perform. So we're going to go through do a harmonic study. We have our model here, and what we're going to do is we're going to start setting up the details on this. So again, applying our material, I'm going to go through and say let's make this an aluminum. We're going to say it's 6061. Excuse me. Got a little bit of a scratchy throat this morning. We'll apply that. We'll also put in our supports on this. So I'm going to say let's put in a fixed geometry. We're going to fix this end. Make sure I get both those faces there. And I also want to put in that remote load. Now we're saying that those the motor and the prop together are 35 grams, so I'm just going to put that in there. I'm just going to right mouse click, say let's put in a remote mass, and I'm just going to select the faces that maybe this would be connected to get it in a good location. In terms of the location, I'm going to look at my global coordinate system. I'm going to say that this is 15 millimeters up above that, and then for my mass, it's in kilograms, but we're just going to put in 0.035. And if there was more details, like rotational information you want to capture in there as well, you could do so. We're just going to put in that value, just the overall mass of this object. But you can see it gives you a preview of the location of where it's going to be. All right, so we have that in there. And at this point, what we want to do is maybe create our mesh. We'll leave that on draft mesh. And I also mentioned that what we need to do is we need to start this off by performing we need to gather some information for the study, performing a natural frequency analysis. So before I finish up the portion for the dynamic harmonic response, I'm going to right mouse click here, and you can see there's run, but there's run frequency as well. So I'm going to go ahead and say let's run frequency. Kind of uneventful, it looks like nothing occurred there. I don't see any plots that showed up. But if I right mouse click down here, I can say, let's see our resonant frequencies again. We can see the details that are provided to us. So it tells us what the frequency is for that and some other information as well. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take some of these as ones that I'm considering as my operating range, and I'm going to bring them into an Excel document. And I'm going to use Excel to help me just set up some of the other information I'm going to be putting in here. But you can see my frequencies in there. What we're going to do is we're going to put in a load profile. So I mentioned that this is now the system's response to some kind of a load, maybe coming from a motor in this case here. We're going to say that our motor is traveling through a certain range of speed, but also that due to some imbalances, maybe with the propeller, some allowable imbalances, that we're going to get some kind of induced load from this. And we're going to wind up putting that into our study. So continuing on with this, I'll come back to grabbing that data later. We'll take a look at some of the details here we're going to work with. So I'm going to apply some dampening to this, since we're now getting into a response type problem. Now you're going to see here it's telling us like modal damping and rally damping. I think if I go to help here, it can give you a little more specifics on this, but these are coefficients that you have to put into the model to define the damping that exists. Now it's a little beyond the scope of what we're doing here to discuss how to get those values, but if you just search the knowledge base and you search rally damping, you'll see that there's calculators in there. And I think there's three different knowledge base articles that cover rally dampening, and they give you some examples of how to extract that information. So search the knowledge base for this information. It's beyond the scope of what we can kind of cover here. I'm going to use the default values for this, and just it's just for presentation purposes to get some data in there. So we have our damping values in there. We also need to place a load in here. And the load, what we're going to do is we're going to apply a load where the motor would be and just say that there's some induced load from an imbalance in the propeller and some allowable amount that we're going to design to. So I'm going to go in here and say, let's apply a force. And I'll apply a force to the same location where the motor is mounted, except obviously not in that direction. It's not going to go out radially. What we want to do is have it go in a selected direction. So I'm going to use a selected direction. I'm going to say normal to that, and I'm going to leave that at 1 newtons for now. And the reason why is we're going to now have a load profile put into this based on the frequency ranges that this can run through. And then we'll show you what that graph looks like. So I'm using 1 because it's just a simple multiplier then. It's 1 times whatever the value would be in that profile. So there's going to be a variation with frequency that's used to define that profile, and we'll go ahead and edit that. And this is where I can put in, I want to make sure I change here, hertz, our frequency range that we're going to work with. It's going to start at 0. I could just type in the values here, but I'm going to pull from here some multiplying values. So I'm going to say that it's going to maybe start at 50 at that hertz range, and then maybe go up to 75. Now I'm just going to key in some values, but this is data that you would pull maybe from some testing with an accelerometer or some forces that you measured in some way. And yes, we could do things like in terms of G's instead of in newtons if we wanted to. So we'll go ahead and put in here 92, we'll get down to 95, 97, so just kind of run through this real quick here. And we'll see what this looks like. Again, I got to make sure that I have the units correct here when I do this. This is in hertz. My column here is in hertz. My maximum value is 14,351. I'm going to go back here. I'm just going to paste that into my system here. So now this is the variation with load with frequency. And remember, I said I was using 1 here. So at 11,000 hertz, we're seeing about 100 newtons at that. And it's a harmonic load, so it's just an impulse or a short period of time that that's being applied. So we'll go ahead and say okay to that and get that in there. A few other things in our harmonic response, we do want to set up some other properties of our study, like the number of frequencies that it's going to run through is what gave us back the frequency range. But I'm going to change the solver here to direct sparse solver. It's just for this particular type of study, there's greater stability and convergence for these harmonic response studies. So I'm going to use the direct bar solvers. There is mention of that in the online help for this application. On the harmonic options, I'm going to use the maximum range that we're just trying to work to. So 14, I think it was 351, that's what we're going to work to. And then over in the advanced options, I have some other things here where I can tell it the number of points. Basically, what we're telling it here is the number of iterations that we want to solve through. It's this times the number of frequencies that we're going through. So I think we were looking at maybe like 8. I'm just going to say put 5 here, and it's going to then go through a certain number of steps in its calculation. And I believe we have everything set up for our harmonic response at this point. What we'll do is in this time, instead of run frequency, we're just going to run our analysis. You can see here it's running through 46 steps. So it was actually 9 frequency ranges times 5. I know that's 45. If there's a plus 1 to that all the time in terms of the number of steps it goes through. There's an initial step that it includes in it. It's kind of running through its analysis. Now, keep in mind we're using draft elements, a very coarse mesh. You would be just looking at these results initially to see if everything looks acceptable to you, reasonable in terms of the deformation shapes, and then after that you're converging with the higher order elements. These are the best practices. Kind of start simple, then observe what's going on, and then you're going to use those higher order elements in a finer mesh. Obviously it will take longer to run through those iterations then. So looking at what we have here, we can see that we have our stress results. I also have a displacement result, but it's looking at that plot step, the 14,351 hertz that we were working with, and I can look at different ones as well. Now, what's of interest to me here is I'm looking at the stress, and I can see the stress result at that frequency range, but what also I can do, what I recommend with looking at these results is go ahead and probe this. I'm going to zoom into this range here. Now, when I'm probing, I'm picking off the element. So I kind of see it with the choppy mesh that we have. I can really pick out where nodes are in this case here. So I'm going to pick that one off. And that does correspond with the highest value in this case here. So that was what I was looking for. If I want to see the variation in stress at that point with frequency, that maximum range here, all I have to do is go here on my report options now and say, let's look at the response, and it's showing me that versus the frequency range. So I can see, even though the load was smaller at those lower frequency ranges, it was like half the value, the stress is much higher. And the reason why is it's just we're looking at much shorter durations for the application of that load further down on the higher frequency ranges. But it gives me a clear picture now of what we're getting in terms of this harmonic response. And a way to look at this is, you know, I'm showing you this example with a quadcopter, but if you have brackets or components like being supported by a part of the frame and you have somewhere a very heavy oscillating component that's maybe inducing some vibration, you want to see what the response is, you can basically run this type of a study to capture what the stresses would be on that bracket, that support element for those other components. So for machine design, some kind of a vehicle design, if we're looking at the trains or automobile type industry where you have, you know, cyclic components rotating and inducing some kind of vibration, you want to see that response. This is an exceptional tool to find that information. So those are the two studies that we wanted to go through in our demonstration to kind of wrap things up here. Obviously, why would we want to perform vibration analysis on our designs? Things like we want to improve the durability, the quality of our products, kind of run them through these tests to see what the response is. And when I say durability, we know we're ensuring that it's strong enough, that it's going to last its lifetime. But the quality end of that is, you know, is this thing going to resonate? Is it going to start vibrating? And that can create noise that's maybe not desirable. And a great example of that is think of like an inexpensive, air conditioning unit that you may have purchased, and you hear the rattling that it makes when it's getting that induced vibration, maybe from the propeller kind of spinning and it's blowing air over something, and it's getting that beating effect on maybe some of the things that are supposed to direct the air. it gets that noise, and it's that annoying noise you would hear. So it's just even that quality of the product, like the perception from the customer of what this thing's going to sound like. So that's why you want to perform these vibration analyses, strength, but also just the overall quality. It's also just a very cost-effective method of checking these things. Some of us have to run through, you know, required tests for the Department of Transportation and Department of Defense, that we have to pass those things. We go through physical testing. This is a great way to check and reduce the number of iterations you're going to go through on those kind of studies. So the things we covered here, we went through a very simple natural frequency analysis. You saw how quick it was to set up. We talked about some best practices on that. Not a lot, but just kind of spoke to like things like keeping it simple with the draft elements, the simplification of reducing some of the components, the detail, but in this case, natural frequency analysis, we wanted to eliminate the idea of using symmetry because it can get rid of some of the modal shapes that we would be dealing with. And the other study we went through was the harmonic response type analysis, and that was the last one we did there, which can be a very important one for us as well. We can see those actual stresses. There's several other types of related studies, I'll say, like there's transient shock analysis that we can do and response spectral analysis, random vibration analysis, and I listed out some standards here, that standard test that people have to meet for certain industries. And then even like looking overall duration of the product, looking at fatigue, and we'll probably cover a random vibration fatigue example in our next event on the 6th, but kind of gives you, you know, the idea that there's much more to do here. In terms of like where within the portfolio we covered things, in this case here, looking at the different levels, there's SOLIDWORKS Premium that gives you the static analysis tools. Frequency analysis falls into Simulation Professional. So this first thing, just looking for the resonance, that's right there in Simulation Professional. And later on downstream, the linear dynamic gave us all those other things that I either demonstrated, the harmonic analysis and all those other ones we mentioned as well, that list I mentioned there. So to kind of wrap things up, just wanted to see if there was any questions you may have and see if we can answer anything. But also, we do have another session on fatigue and buckling. We'll probably cover mostly fatigue on that one, but it's going to be on, I think that's December 4th, Friday, December 4th at 10 a.m. What I'm going to do here is I'm going to push that out here on the chat interface. So on the GoToWebinar piece here, you'll see that there's a chat section where you can throw some information in there. I'm going to put the link out there. So you guys can, if you want to register now, you can just click on that. And it would take you right to the registration location. I'll leave that up there. Now, there's also a questions interface in our GoToWebinar tool here that we're using. If you have any questions, you know, just kind of throw them out there. I'll see if whatever I can answer here right now, or if I have to take the question and kind of get back to you, I'll let you know if you need to. So, just want to see if there's any questions. All right, so that wraps things up. We appreciate your time, and thank you for attending our event.